Coming to the next part, we have the how and the where. We covered the why in the earlier part of this episode, and now we are looking into the how and the where. So, as you can see, let's play the clip. What do you suggest? Let's play the clip.
So, reincarnation is not a why, but a how. It functions this way. And it's a way for individual beings that are really nothing but the one being to express themselves freely and face the consequences of the results of their own choices.
Okay, so that is the how and where as per Rajiv. Okay. So, Jerry, your thoughts on this?
Okay. Sri Rajiv Malhotra sir again is saying that the how part, which he presents as the how part, he's basically saying that it is the accountability, like whatever you do, you face the consequences. In the last episode itself, if you haven't seen it, please see the last episode on karma.
Excuse me, but please do see it. Correct. Because it's got some shocking revelations as to whether the standard of accountability really is maintained as karma. And whatever is being propagated as far as the Western philosophers are concerned of Hindutva and in pop media is utter rubbish, and it's even in that sense it is fraught with logical inconsistencies. But going ahead, that's not what classical Hinduism is all about. These are new stories which is made up by people like Rajiv Malhotra when they get embarrassed with the facts from their books. So yeah, just to summarize, yes.
In the last episode, we had covered on karma, and we had very clearly demonstrated that karma is not just basically what you reap of your own actions.
Cannot be transferred and stuff, yeah.
Correct. Cannot be transferred or cannot be stolen. We had shown from Brahadaryanga Upanishad 6.4.3 and Brahadaryanga Upanishad 6.4.12 and Kausadika Brahmana Upanishad 2.15 that it can be stolen, it can be transferred. So basically what Rajiv Malhotra says, sir says, is doesn't stand.
And that too, the methodology is very embarrassing. Maybe
correct,
that could
correct,
be the reason.
Correct. And further adding on to the last episode, see, if at all there needs to be an accountability, if at all you need to account it, you need to have a method of accounting it.
Yes.
You need to have a method of accounting it, and see if Sri Rajiv Malhotra sir is speaking about the accountability part, he should have gone and explained how it is accounted.
Yeah.
Like if you are in an exam, even if you are marking in the examination, how it is graded should be given.
Yes.
And you have it in the Hindu scriptures, and you have it in the Kanteyoga Upanishad, which is the Shruti literature. This is not some peripheral literature that we are picking up. These are the foundational text of the Hinduism.
Not like an extra biblical or extra Hindu text which can just be brushed away.
Correct.
This is foundational theology, like how we have in Christians, like the book of Hebrews or the book of Romans, and a deep theology.
Correct.
So the Upanishads are those deep theological books of Hinduism, classical Hinduism. Yes.
So in Kandayoga Upanishad 5.10, 1 to 10, if you read, it is all about karma and reincarnation. So it says that there are three paths, basically three paths depending upon what your karma is. First, if you are in a forest meditating upon Brahma, all those things, then you go to the world of the gods.
Wow, okay. And you can see the reference on the screen.
Correct.
Yeah.
Similarly, if you are the second path is the method is actually if you are doing the Vedic rituals, like village practices, that is how it is mentioned.
Right.
Then you go to the world of the fathers after the death. So you know how you are going to be evaluated.
Yes.
Now, if you do not do, then there is a problem.
Neither of them.
Neither of these ways.
Yeah.
Are of those small creatures, it says about small creatures, you can also fall into that state. That will be, we will see from the commentary of Shankaracharya and
going ahead. Yeah.
Going ahead.
Yeah.
So then you keep on, you don't get the next chance to write the exam.
Yes, it's over.
It's over. There is no further chances given to the exam. You will keep on dying and coming back to
in life. Case you're unfortunate enough to land in the third category, you will never be reincarnated as a human being. You'll always be the lesser creatures.
And the cycle will keep on repeating,
like a worm.
Correct.
Like a worm and ant and
correct,
termites
mosquito.
And stuff. Yeah, yeah, mosquito and stuff.
Yeah, yeah. So about the third path, commentary by Adi Shankaracharya, he says that this position of the small creatures represent the third position of the people fallen on the wheel of the birth and the death. In reference to and as distinguished from the two paths described above, from the path of the gods and the path of the fathers.
Wow.
So this is Adi Shankaracharya, and you can see the complete, read the complete commentary for this particular section here. Similarly, for the Sarvapalli Radhakrishnan also say that if you do neither means the first two things, that you don't go meditate or you don't do the Vedic sacrifices, will continually revolt like this little
creatures.
You have fallen into that third category where you don't get a chance to write the exam.
And again, to reiterate, Sarvapalli Radhakrishnan, Dr. Sarvapalli Radhakrishnan, is not a small man.
Yeah.
He was one of the first presidents of India and an acknowledged scholar in Hinduism.
And similarly, Adi Shankaracharya is considered as one of the probably the greatest scholar of Hinduism that ever lived.
He has written commentaries upon commentaries, and nobody can just dismiss him out.
Correct. So to summarize this marking criteria as per the Kanta Yoga Upanishad, you have three groups.
Yes.
One passed. Another failed, but attendee is given again.
Yes.
And
you can do. Yeah.
You can come back re-attempt. Not by benefiting the previous study, you will have to study again because all your memory will be...
Memories are gone.
Memories are gone when you are actually reincarnated.
Yes.
You don't
get
the benefit of, unlike the school, you don't get the benefit of the past studies.
Yes.
And then you can write the exam. And the third group is completely expelled from this exam.
Totally
expelled. So it's a very cruel system actually.
Yes.
And second, and now if this was the only marking criteria or the accountability criteria, we would have... Okay, that is how it is,
how
life
it is.
Yes. But unfortunately, when we come to Gita, you see a totally different criteria.
And for most, it is Gita at this time is one of the most revered books in Hinduism across the world.
Correct.
And Srimad Bhagavatam is again, what do you mean?
Correct. Srimad Bhagavatam is also the most popular of all the Puranas.
Yes.
It has
maximum number of commentaries.
Yeah, 81 medieval Sanskrit commentaries alone for the Bhagavata Purana, whereas the many other Puranas doesn't even have one single Sanskrit commentary. So that being the popular, we will look at that. And in Bhagavad Gita 8.6, Sri Krishna now gives a different criteria. So he says, whatever one remembers upon giving up the body at the time of death, that state one attains. For example, he goes on in 8, 9 to 10, says that, see, if somebody remembers him, steadily remembers the divine Lord with great devotion, he certainly attains him.
Yes.
So this is now a new criteria.
We covered again in the last episode
that
even if you've committed the most abominable sins, you can see the reference. Don't believe my word. Look it up.
Correct.
Most abominable sins. If you just show bhakti or devotion to Krishna, it's all well and fair.
And this is now like saying that if you have 100
karma has gone through the window.
Correct. Karma has gone to the window, and now you have 100 questions in a question paper. You were wrong in all the 99 questions, and the final one question that is at the remembering Krishna or the other divine gods of Hinduism.
No, only Krishna, brother.
In this case, only Krishna.
Yeah. Yeah.
In this case, only Krishna. But generally speaking, if whatever you remember, you will reach there. If you remember Indra at the time, you will reach Indra's law.
But that's like at a lower level.
Correct, at a lower level.
Yeah.
So, now only the final question matters.
Don't
all
matter.
The 99 questions, accountability of Sri Rajiv Malhotra sir has gone out of the list.
Paying of sins.
Everything is gone out. Everything is gone out. So, now that is the Gita's criteria.
There was this, one of my relatives gifted me the books of, Sri Prabhupada, who is the founder of ISKCON. You have centers across the world. You may have seen them, heard them. And I read a book about on reincarnation, and he brings up this interesting, episode from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 5, Chapter 8. And it's very elaborate, but just to summarize it in the best way possible, there's this King Bharata, and he rejects everything and he goes to the jungle, and he dedicates himself to seeking Krishna. He cuts himself off from all attachments everywhere, but then he goes closer to Krishna. And what happens is that towards the end of as he goes ahead, he finds a small deer whom he saves from dying. Then he grows very attached to the deer. Now what happens is that he grows very attached. He used to play with it, sleep with it, feed it, and carry it around, everything. And then one day he wakes up and finds that deer is gone. So what he does, he goes around looking for the deer. He goes around looking for the deer, looks, doesn't find it, falls off from somewhere, and as he's about to die, the face of the deer comes in front of him. And what happens is, because he was seeking the deer, and the last thing on his mind when he was dying was the deer, he gets reborn as a deer.
Correct.
All his karma, everything gone, he gets reborn as a deer. All his past karma, all seeking, all dedication to Krishna, everything is gone. The last thing that he saw was a deer. He came across as a deer. And there's even the Gita verse for that, right?
Correct. Actually, that is what the Gita also agrees with that.
Yes, and you can see the verse on the screen.
Correct.
So the last thing that you focus on is what you'll be reborn as.
Correct. So this is like saying that while I'm dying, if I think that I'll be born in Bill Gates' house, using the same example.
The same example of Malhotra.
Malhotra,
sir.
Yes. Then I'll be born in the
Bill Gates' house. Yes. All karma, everything.
Everything
gone
is gone.
Gone. Yes.
Yeah. So again, sir, when you are speaking about karma, please start referring to giving us the reference and giving us the evidence instead of speaking in air. That might be good to bluff the Western masters, but it is not good enough for the Indians who knows in the Hindus.
Yes.
So again, somebody can say that Bhagavad Gita, in fact, is not providing a different criteria from Kanta Yoga Upanishad. In fact, chapter 8, verse 23 to 26. It has similar words, but the concept is totally different.
New criteria,
sir. It is not a different criteria.
Yes.
It is not a same criteria. It is actually
new
a different
criteria. Yeah.
Different criteria. Now, what, before we complete this house and why, house and where, this question about the how, there is one point that Sri Rajiv Malhotra sir refers in this clip. So again, if you look at Bhagavad Gita chapter 8, verse 23 to 26, you might think that it is a new criteria. The wordings are very similar to Kanda Yoga Upanishad. So initial reading, unless you read it carefully, you might think that it is the same criteria, but it is different. It is different. For example, you can read the entire thing in the slide. But for example, if you die during the first 6 months of the sun's southern course, the dark fortnight of the moon, then you go to a different place.
Yes.
So now the time of your death also matters.
Exactly. And look at the next slide.
Correct.
It simply says, that's from the Gita again.
Yeah.
And it simply says that if you die during the day, you will go to heaven. Means to be with Krishna. If you die during the night, you will not go to Krishna.
Correct.
So that is like...
The part of the day also now matters.
Now the part of the day, forget your karma.
Yeah.
Forget karma is out of the window. It is over.
Correct.
Yeah.
So in whichever way you look at it, each of the text seems to be giving a different criteria to evaluate. So how will I be judged? Again, the how is gone.
First of all, is there a judgment?
Correct. At least
there is no judgment.
There is no judgment, but is there an accountability?
Yes.
Is there an accountability? If there is, what is the criteria for that accountability? That is also gone.
Yes.
So now, before we look into the other W's and
other questions. Yeah.
There is one correction that we have to give.
A truth pill
from a Vedic drishti.
For Mr. Rajiv Malhotra. Okay.
So while speaking about the accountability part, Sri Rajiv Malhotra sir was saying that, see, if a person is born in a poor family, that is because of his past karma. Somebody with a disability. That is because of his past karma. I wonder why he is not using a Vedic example.
And he also gives the example of Bill Gates.
Bill Gates.
So if somebody is born in the house of Bill Gates, it's because of his past karma. So because he was a good man, his father was given as Bill Gates. So he gets born in the family of Bill Gates.
Correct.
Yes, the question as you rightly asked is, why this example?
Why this example? Why not from your Shruti literature, from your foundational text? From Kanda Yoga Upanishad, the same passage we spoke about the reincarnation, exactly the same passage, the 7, Kanda Yoga 7, it says, those who are conduct themselves, those whose conducts are good, they will be either born as Brahmin, depending upon their karma, or Kshatriya, or Vaishya, or Shudra. This is the example that you should have given. Caste system is based on this reincarnation.
And if you read the whole thing,
correct.
those who do evil will quickly attain an evil birth. Listen to this, and again we covered this more in detail in episode 9. the birth of a dog, the birth of a hog, or the birth of a chandala. Chandala means like the untouchables.
Yeah. So
why didn't he take this example, brother?
Correct. He should have given this example rather than giving an example which appeals to the Western mind.
Yes.
He should have gone by your Vedic drishti, sir. And now, Sri Rajiv Malhotra, sir, is speaking about racism and all. Sir, if you read Bible, you have lot to correct yourself both from the Hinduism and Christianity. It is only the Bible which says that all human beings are from the same blood, all from the same one man and one woman.
Yes.
That everybody came.
Adam and Eve.
No
up, no down.
Correct. But it is your karma and reincarnation and the Hindu scriptures that has brought the caste system, and we don't want to deal with that in this episode because we have already dealt with that
earlier.
But let me just add what was the situation in Kerala.
Mm.
They were not allowed to, the women were not allowed to cover the upper part of the body.
Mm.
The food that was given, they were given rats, dead cows. These were the foods given. They started eating rice when the Britishers came to Kerala.
And surprisingly, Rajiv blames the Britishers for the caste system.
Caste system. So, sir, you get your historical facts, the biblical facts and your Vedic facts correct before you air your opinion and make yourself ridiculed in the eyes of the people.
Thank you for being with us. Drop us a line at sakshi.apologeticsnetwork@gmail.com, as you can see. And thank you for your love, prayers and whatever comments that you do drop in. Do like, subscribe and share this video. Thank you again and have a wonderful day. God bless. Thank you, Jerry.